Oh, hi there. I was just getting home and, I was thinking, it's been a long time since we've had anybody over to our house, COVID and all. Thought this would be a great opportunity to invite you in and take a look around. Join me. It's been almost 3 years now since my wife and I were able to purchase our home, and God really put a lot of things into place to allow that to happen. And when we first bought this home, looked nothing like it does today. In fact, the floors had water damage, and underneath that there was mold. A lot of the same original fixtures from when it was built were in place, the lights, the cabinets, and even the tile floor. But my wife and I have watched enough HGTV to know that we wanted things to look a little bit different. And so, thanks to the help of some friends and family and a few hard weeks of work, really, our house looks nothing like it used to when we first bought it. And for that, we are truly thankful. Part of the Lord's Prayer that we're going to look at this week says, "Give us today our daily bread." Now, I've got a little bit of a problem with that phrase because you see, 13 years ago, I was diagnosed as gluten intolerant. That means my body can't properly digest gluten. And gluten is a component of many common grains, including wheat. Wheat that's used to make flour, flour that's used to make bread. Therefore, I can't eat bread. So why does God tell me to pray for bread when he knows that I can't eat it? Well, first, we should probably decide if when Jesus was giving this example of prayer, he was really talking about bread. You remember Elijah, one of God's great prophets of the Old Testament? During his life, there was a time frame where there was a lack of rain causing a lack of crops to grow. We call this a famine. God had told Elijah to go and live near a brook, a small stream. As you can probably imagine, there weren't lush gardens of plentiful produce around this tiny little stream in the middle of nowhere. But God still had a plan to provide for Elijah, to provide what he needed as he was doing what God commanded. 1 Kings chapter 17, verses 5 and 6 says, "So Elijah did as the Lord told him and camped beside Kereth Brook, east of the Jordan. The ravens brought him bread and meat each morning and evening, and he drank from the brook." Guess this was a beta run for Uber Eats a couple thousand years ahead of time, but Raven Eats didn't have a very extensive menu to choose from. God provided Elijah, his prophets, with bread and meat, literally, as he lived near the brook. But that interesting story doesn't end there. Since there was a famine and thus a shortfall of rain, eventually that little brook dried up. That source of water that Elijah had depended on was gone. There were no faucets to pipe in water from the Jordan River. The Romans hadn't built the aqueducts yet. And so Elijah was facing a serious problem. But God didn't abandon Elijah here. There's more to this miraculous appearance of food. God told Elijah to go live in a town called Zarephath, and that a widow who lived there would feed him. It might not seem like such a big deal today, but back in Bible times, this would have been a bigger problem. You see, a widow had essentially lost her source of income when her husband died. She had to fend for herself. And that certainly would be complicated by the fact that there was a famine. When Elijah asked this particular widow if she could bring him some bread to eat, she said she had none. In fact, all she had left in her house was a small handful of flour and just a little bit of oil. She was about to prepare a last meal for herself and her son, and then presumably they would starve to death. And now, here's this strange man asking for some bread. But God, through the words of Elijah, promised to take care of this woman, and Elijah too. Elijah told her that the flour and the oil would not run out until the famine was over. 1 Kings chapter 17, verses 15 and 16 said, "So she did as Elijah said, and she and Elijah and her family continued to eat for many days. There was always enough flour and olive oil left in the containers, just as the Lord had promised through Elijah." two instances of God directly providing bread. But there's another unique incident to talk about. It happened earlier in Scripture, Exodus to be exact. Do you remember the main book of the, remember the main event of the book of Exodus? The Israelites were leaving Egypt, literally in Exodus. And what happened after that? The Israelites had lived in oppression in Egypt, and while they were there, they complained a fair amount. And when they finally escaped, according to God's plan, they still complained. It wasn't easy walking around the desert. And they remembered how much they had back in Egypt. They talked about the pots of meat they would sit around and eating all the bread they wanted. Things were a little harder to come by in the wilderness, but God provided. Much like opening your front door and finding the McDonald's Big Mac meal that DoorDash left on your front step, waiting there for you, the Israelites stepped out of their tents each morning and found this bread substance covering the ground. They asked each other what it was, and that's what gave us the word for it, manna. And if that miraculous bread raining down from heaven each morning wasn't enough, God also caused quail to come and cover the ground in the evening. Meat and bread sent directly from God. But the story in Exodus 16 also demonstrates the Israelites' dependence on God. He specifically told them to gather only what they needed for a day and not to keep any until the next day. And some of them, seemingly not trusting what God had promised, took more than they needed and found it spoiled the next morning. Similarly, God told them to gather double what they needed on the day before the Sabbath, because nothing would come on the Sabbath day itself. But again, some didn't seem to believe what God said, didn't trust him, and went out on the Sabbath only to find nothing there. In each of these situations, there was a clear dependence on God. A dependence on God for food. It seems that without the providence of God, none of these people would have survived their situations. Yet it's also important to note that the Bible says that they had more than enough. It wasn't just enough to get by. No one was saying they were still hungry after they ate what the Lord provided. And ultimately, the Israelites were given a bountiful land, the land of Canaan, which is said to be flowing with milk and honey. So when we pray, give us today our daily bread, are we literally asking God for bread? Yes. Well, sort of. Bread and other food that we need to survive. Now, note that I said need, not want. We don't really need that tub of chocolate chip cookie dough ice cream that's in our freezer to survive. We don't really need the extra large bag of nacho cheese Doritos to survive. We don't even really need the Churrasco steak to survive. But interestingly enough, we have all of that. God has provided the food that we need to live and more. We ought not to take it for granted. There's much that goes into being able to have that food on our shelves and in our refrigerators. And God has put all that into motion. There are farmers out there who grow that food, truckers who bring it to the stores where we can shop and buy that food. Our parents have jobs, skills that they use to earn money that we can use to buy that food. But without God blessing each of those steps along the way, it wouldn't be possible. And the same is true for much of the rest of our lives. That car I was driving at the beginning of chapel today, it's in pretty good shape. And God has provided the means for me and my wife to make a monthly payment to own that car. This house that I showed you around earlier, even in the rough shape it was originally in, a very generous blessing from God, who's not only provided my wife and I a safe place to live, but he's also provided us with the means to make it look nicer in our eyes. Could we live and do the things necessary to survive without a car or a super nice house? Certainly. But God has provided that to us and more. More than we need. And through it all, we must recognize His hand in providing that to us, not taking it for granted, and to continue to ask Him to give us our daily bread. As we get ready to sing our song today, I'd like to talk about some words of Jesus from Matthew chapter 6. Jesus talks about how God provides for the birds and allows lovely fields of flowers to grow. And if we are more important to God than birds or flowers, and we are, then we, like the Israelites, need to place our trust in Him to provide us with what we need. Matthew chapter 6, verses 31 through 33 says, "So don't worry about these things, saying, 'What will we eat? What will we drink? What will we wear?' Your heavenly Father already knows all your needs. Seek the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously, and He will give you everything you need." Our song today talks about those who are hungry and thirsty and how God will satisfy. There's really a double meaning to that. Yes, God is going to provide for our earthly needs, but He gives us more. He also provides for our souls. We talk about how God gives us all the earthly things that we need, but He also gives us the thing that we need most for eternity, Jesus. The refrain of the song today is based on the well-known verse from John chapter 3, verse 16. "For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have eternal life." You know, Pastor Caleb is getting pretty good at this video editing thing, and I have a feeling that he might just pop up and join us right over there.
God so loved.
Let's close with a prayer. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you for inviting us to pray for our daily bread, for understanding this not only means the things that we need every day to survive, but also all of the blessings that you will give us, trusting that you in fact will keep your promises, just as you kept your promise to Elijah and to the Israelites to feed them. You too will do the same for us. And how we are so much more important to you than the birds of the air or the flowers of the field, to not worry about what we will eat and what we will drink and what we will wear, but rather to put our faith and our trust in you to provide, giving us what we need and recognizing the difference between a need and a want. You provide us with so much in our lives, and for that, keep us truly thankful. All of this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look on you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. Have a wonderful day.
Good morning, middle school students. It is time to give out the January Shark Award. This month's recipient of the Shark Award was nominated for their dedication in the classroom as well as their academic success. The student works hard in all subject areas and maintains excellent grades. The student participates often in class and consistently submits high-quality work. The student is kind and respectful to their teachers. The student displays a positive attitude, keeping recess games and conversations among classmates lighthearted, positive, and fun. The January recipient of the Shark Award is an eighth grader, a boy. Congratulations to Mateo Sotelo.